Hey guys. Hi everyone. I am really glad to be here with you in the today. I wanted to take this opportunity to tell you a little bit about my project AsteroidOS. So I imagine that most of you have never heard about AsteroidOS before. So I will start with a very general introduction of the project, and then I will move on to some more technical tasks. So what is AsteroidOS? AsteroidOS is an operating system for smartwatches. It's running right here in front of you. It can be seen as an alternative to Android Wear systems. So if you have an Android Wear smartwatch, such as the LG Watch or LG Watch Urban, you can usually replace Android with AsteroidOS. I have been working on it for 2 years now, plenty of work on it. Currently looks like this, so there's been a lot of effort for design, etc. It runs on 10 different models of smartwatches, and some users reported battery life for up to 1 week on a single charge, which isn't that bad for a smartwatch. And something I want to focus on is that AsteroidOS is also a community project, so this is a part of the project that I really wanted to nurture since the beginning of AsteroidOS. So I try to organize meetups wherever I go. We have meetups in Berlin, in Brussels, in London, in hacker spaces, restaurants, pubs, and I also try to give talks to make the contributions easier for newcomers. So hopefully this talk will give you a better idea of how AsteroidOS works, so that maybe you could contribute someday. So when I said that AsteroidOS is an operating system, I actually mean this is an embedded Linux system. I assume that most of you are familiar with desktop Linux systems, but not necessarily with embedded Linux systems. So I will try to explain the architecture of AsteroidOS in comparison to the architecture of a typical desktop Linux distribution. So in embedded Linux system, of course there is Linux system, so you expect it to run some kind of kernel. And right now it's important to make a great distinction between the mainline Linux kernel, the one you can find on kernel.org, that is maintained by Linus Torvalds and that includes the official kernel drivers that respect the correct APIs, and the ones we have on the consumer devices. When you buy a smartwatch, it is built by OEM, original equipment manufacturer, that provide you with a vendor kernel, which doesn't include mainline drivers. So usually those are lower quality of code, and it can cause security and interoperability problems. Unfortunately, we cannot run mainline Linux kernels on our smartwatches yet, so AsteroidOS makes use of vendor kernel. And that causes all kinds of problems that will be the topic of my next part. When I say Linux system, I also mean that it runs all kinds of standard user space daemons. For example, systemd. I won't talk about systemd much more because I know that Leonard is here in the building and I don't want him to have fun of me. But other daemons include Bluesy or Quanman, which are typical connectivity tasks on the desktop Linux system. And in embedded Linux system, there is also the keyword embedded. And what this typically means is that you are very much constrained by your hardware and your CPU. But this is not the case in smartwatches. Actually, in all the smartwatches that are supported by AsteroidOS, we have quad-core CPU, which is way much more than what we need. So one of the first things that AsteroidOS does is cut the capability of those CPU to maintain battery life. So when I say embedded, I don't mean low capabilities. But what I mean with embedded is that we have to take care of the hardware. For example, with the UI, you cannot expect to run your full KDE desktop on your smartwatch. That would not be usable. So of course I had to develop a new apps and a new launcher, etc. I will get back to it. And what I mean with UI is also the graphics stack. The graphics stack is different from the one you use on your desktop Linux system. And there has been all kind of integration work for this. That will actually be the topic of my first part. And then there is also connectivity. So usually on smartwatch, you don't have a Wi-Fi chip, so you need to use Bluetooth. So of course it changes the way apps communicate with other systems, and there has been a lot of work for the Bluetooth stack in Asteroid OS. That will also be the topic of one of my parts. What I mean with embedded is also that you need to take care about stacks that you usually don't care about on a desktop Linux system. For example, sensors. You need to care a lot about battery life. I've put tremendous amounts of time in enhancing the battery life so that it becomes usable on a daily basis. And other stacks such as USB, you don't want to run as a USB host, the USB gadget, so there have been efforts in it. And also the CPU architecture. Of course, those smartwatches are running ARM CPUs, so you cannot just compile your apps from your desktop computer. You need to cross-compile everything. So usually you need a build system, and that will actually be the topic of my last part. To sum things up, I will talk about the graphics stack, then Bluetooth stack, other example of stacks, just to give you a clear idea of what runs on AsteroidOS, but that will be very brief. And then finally, I will tell you a little bit more about the build system. Let's start with the graphics stack. So today, everything becomes smart. And what this usually means is that you are able to run apps on it. So if someday you can run apps on your shoes, those will be smart shoes. And when I started to develop AsteroidOS, I tried to find a nice way to develop apps for Asteroid. So this is a problem that has been made by Nokia a few years ago when they worked on Migo. And they invested a lot of money and time in something called Qtquick, which is a framework for accelerated, hardware-accelerated user experience. So Qtquick can be used with the QML language, which is declarative. So it's very easy to use. You can bind properties between each other. It can be extended with some JavaScript code, so you have a lot of possibilities with Qtquick. It is known by mobile Linux developers because Qtquick is also used by most of the other mobile Linux systems, such as FOSS OS. It was used by Ubuntu Touch when it was still developed, and other things such as WebOS, etc. In AsteroidOS, we provide something called QML Asteroid, which is a set of components and tools to access often used components and properties of the system from your QML apps. And developers can also use all the modules that are provided by Qt. And there are plenty of them. They are very easy to use, and they offer a lot of capabilities. But once again, I will get back to it later. So typically on a smart device, you do not want to run a single app. You expect it to have some kind of window management and maybe also compositing capabilities. And that is when Wayland enters the party. In AsteroidOS, you could not run Xorg, the Xorg server, because of problems on the graphics stack. So we need to use Wayland. Also, Wayland is becoming more and more present in desktop Linux distributions. I often find that people don't know what Wayland really is. So just to make things clear, Wayland is only a protocol. It's a standard that describes the way apps should communicate with a Wayland compositor. And I like to describe a Wayland compositor as the equivalent of a display server, such as Xorg, a window manager, such as Kwin, and also sometimes the it plays the role of the desktop, such as Plasma, for example. So in AsteroidOS, I created a Wayland compositor named Asteroid Launcher. So we have a couple of screenshots of it here. as you can see, it managed all kind of things, watch faces, app switching, quick settings, notifications, app launcher, window management, etc. Also USB connectivity and plenty of things. And Asteroid launcher is a Wayland compositor that has been developed with Qtwig, thanks to the Qt Wayland compositor API. So I was talking about the power of Qt modules, and the Qt Wayland compositor API is an easy way to create your own Wayland compositor from Qtwig. It's really easy to use, and if you want to write your own Wayland compositor, it's just a few lines of code. Apps are using Wayland EGL to render the content with hardware accelerated capabilities on top of Asteroid launcher. But when I said that a Wayland compositor also plays the role of a display server, I meant that it has to care about the graphics stack and the drivers that are running behind it. So when you are running Asteroid launcher needs to care about the GPU drivers. And as I said before, we are using vendor kernels. We don't have the correct APIs. And we only have what the OEM provides us. And the OEM provides us with Android hardware session layers. So in order to run a Qt app such as Asteroid launcher on different tasks, thankfully the Qt project provides us with something called Qt platform abstraction. QPA are graphic rendering modules that explains how to render the UI on top of a certain stack. You can see several examples of QPA here. For example, Qt running on Android tablets, Qt running on iOS tablets, or on QNX tablets. This is the same app, and this is just using different QPAs. Of course, in AsteroidOS, we have to use certain QPA that complies with the graphic stack that is behind. Thankfully, the guys from Yola, the company behind SafeFishOS, developed something named Hardware Composer. At least they developed a QPA that runs on the Hardware Composer hardware abstraction layers. So the Hardware Composer hardware abstraction layer comes from Android, and this is what the OEM provides us. So when you get a smartwatch, your drivers are Hardware Composer APIs. And the Hardware Composer QPA renders Qt on top of those drivers. But you get a compatibility issue because those Android hardware session layers are compiled for the Android libc, Bionic. And your Linux system is running a different libc, glibc. And you usually cannot run two different libc on a single app. And if you do, this is a really good idea. This is not a really good idea. But that's what we have to do in AsteroidOS. A friend of mine named Carsten Mung came up with a very clever idea named libhybris. This is basically a dirty hack, and I think he would agree with me on this point. But it works, and why wouldn't we use it? So basically, libhybris is a bionic linker inside the glibc library. So what it does is that it loads your Android dynamic libraries from your glibc apps. For example, Asteroid launcher uses the Hardware Composer QPA, which uses libhybris to render content thanks to the Android hardware session layers that are loaded with libhybris. Libhybris can be used to load all kind of abstraction, all kind of libraries and hardware session layers, but it is usually used for GLES rendering. So you can see different examples of low-level GLES demonstration running on top of libhybris. Some of them are from me. On the top, it's an EFL, Enlightenment Foundation Libraries app running on top of libhybris. Then it's a basic QMA app running on one of my smartwatch. And the last one comes from the Plasma Mobile project, and it's a test of GLES running on a Nexus 5, thanks to libhybris once again. So once you get a graphics stack, you can render your apps, which is great, but this is not enough for a really smart system. Your users expect you to have some kind of connectivity. And as I said before, the these smartwatches often don't have a Wi-Fi chip. So you need to use what is available. And what is available in those smartwatches is a Bluetooth chip. The Bluetooth stack of Linux isn't very well documented, and especially the Bluetooth low energy stack. So I hope this talk will help a little bit enhancing the documentation of the Bluetooth low energy stack. As I said before, everything is becoming smart today, and even Bluetooth became smart. So now we have Bluetooth smart since the Bluetooth 4 revision of the Bluetooth consortium. So Bluetooth smart, also known as Bluetooth low energy, has been thought for very low consumption devices, such as a sensor tag that you can place somewhere and forget for 1 year or something, and that will be running on the same battery. Which is great for battery consumption, and this is the reason why I wanted to use Bluetooth Smart in AsteroidOS. But Bluetooth Smart is very constrained in the way communications are handled. This is quite different from what you usually have with, let's say, TCP or something like this. So you need to define profiles for usage-specific applications. The Bluetooth Consortium standardized some usual profiles, such as the battery profile. And whenever I can, I try to implement those standard profiles. For example, when your phone tries to know the battery state of your watch, this is a standard API. But for most use cases, there was no standards defined by the Bluetooth consortium. So you had to come up with new Bluetooth low energy profiles. Some of them include notification synchronizations, so that when you get a notification on your smartphone, your watch vibrates. Also, example include remote music control from your watch to your phone. Taking screenshots of your watch from your phone, and also synchronizing the time of your phone when you connect it to your watch. So all of those usages need a profile implementation, and this needs to be done somewhere. So I wrote a daemon named Asteroid BTSyncD for Bluetooth synchronization daemon that implements those profiles. I like to describe Asteroid BTSyncD as a dbus multiplexer because that's exactly what it is. It offers high-level APIs to the apps. For example, the music control app, Asteroid Music, uses MPRIS, which is a standard also used on desktop Linux systems to control another music player. And the music app uses those API, and they are offered by Asteroid BTSyncD. So by the way, dbus, for those of you who don't know what it is, it allows you to do inter-process communication with remote function calls. Asteroid Music can directly call functions from Asteroid BTSyncD. Other example of dbus APIs that are exposed by Asteroid BTSyncD include the notification profile, which is also a standard from the freedesktop.org project. So once again, I try to follow standards whenever I can. So it means that in AsteroidOS, you can grab your shell, use send notify or leave notify tools that you can usually use on your Linux desktop system, and show notifications in Asteroid Launcher. One last example of high-level API that is offered by Asteroid BTSyncD is the dconf API. Actually, it uses the dconf daemon from the GNOME project, but dconf is usually helpful for configuration values, but it can also be used for caching data. And if you want to know whether it will be raining or not in Gothenburg for the next 5 days, those data are stored in dconf by Asteroid BTSyncD and retrieved by the Asteroid Weather app. So Asteroid BTSyncD implements those different profiles by using the Bluetooth Low Energy APIs from Bluetooth DIP. So once again, those Bluetooth Low Energy APIs are offered through dbus at a different level. So the high-level libhybris API tries to hide the complexity of handling the Bluetooth low energy connection, and Asteroid BTCMD implements this complexity. So if you are familiar with Bluetooth low energy, and unfortunately I don't have the time to get into the details of the vocabulary, but you may know what services, characteristics, and descriptors are, and those three things are defined in Asteroid BTCMD and sent to the Bluetooth daemon, Bluetooth D, with the GAT DBus API. So Bluetooth D comes from the BlueZ project, which is the standard Bluetooth stack for Linux. You may also know Bluetooth BlueDroid from Android, but once again, I try to stick to standards, and the nice way of doing things is to use BlueZ. And BlueZ is made of two parts. In the user space, you get the Bluetooth D daemon and some other tools. And in the kernel, you get the Bluetooth subsystem. So Bluetooth D gathers all information from the debug calls of Asteroid BTCMD and other apps. I give several examples. So the Bluetooth low energy services are provided by BTCMD. And there are other APIs, such as the authentication agent capabilities. When you connect your watch, you need to accept a passkey. And this is handled by the authentication agent. There is also the Bluetooth Low Energy advertising capabilities, which is used to show the device to other Bluetooth Low Energy devices around. So Bluetooth D gathers all those information and generates an HCI byte stream. So for once, this is good to note, HCI is a standard, which means that it's common between Android and Linux, and we don't have to use dirty hacks such as libhybris, which is not always the case. So Bluetooth D generates those HCI byte stream, which are sent through a virtual device, the HCI 0, for example, the kernel, and the kernel does all kind of magic with the Bluetooth controller, and it sends this HCI byte stream via an UART line to the Broadcom's Bluetooth chip. All of these smartwatches that are supported by AsteroidOS have the same Broadcom's Bluetooth chip. Unfortunately for us, this Broadcom's Bluetooth chip needs a firmware, and of course it's closed source, so this is the second binary blob that is used in AsteroidOS. But the rest of the stack is open source. So talking about battery life and Bluetooth low energy, this UART line here is cut when there is no connectivity, and this is handled by the kernel, by a special driver in the kernel that took me a very long time to debug, and when it worked, it multiplied by 5 the battery life of AsteroidOS in a single patch. So I'm really proud to present you this part of the slide. I think that's it. So when the Bluetooth chip receives the HCI byte stream, this is sent through radio waves, and this is received on the other side of the stack by a synchronization client. So in AsteroidOS, I provide a standard reference implementation of a synchronization client, which is named AsteroidOS Sync. So AsteroidOS Sync is an Android app that you can see here. Oh, it's in French. So there are a couple of options in here. The app itself implements the other part of the Bluetooth low energy profile that I told you about before. So this needs to be re-implemented for every smartphone operating system. For example, someone from the community is currently working on something called AsteroidOS Linux, which is a set of Python scripts to control your watch from your desktop Linux system, which is very handy. And I believe it already supports libnotify synchronization between the notifications of your desktop and the ones of your watch. If you want to contribute another synchronization client, for example, for Sci-Fish OS, Of course, your contributions are welcome, and documentation on the Bluetooth Low Energy profile will be provided. You just need to implement those, and you will be able to synchronize your phone with your watch. So I now hope you have a clear understanding of the graphic and Bluetooth stack. And I would like to tell you a little bit more about other stacks, just so that you have a more general overview of AsteroidOS. So most of the slide will be very brief, but hopefully we'll help you understand. Sensor stack. So usually you don't use your sensors on your laptop or desktop. But on a smartwatch, this is really important. So what we want to offer to app developers is high-level APIs. And thankfully, the Qt project once again helps us because it provides a Qt sensors API. Basically, Qt sensors API is pretty much nothing, that's just an API, and it tries to hide the complexity of the backends behind. In AsteroidOS, we use the sensor FW backend, so we have daemon named sensor FWD, which gathers data from all the different sensor sources using different backends. And you get it. We have vendor kernels, so we don't support standard APIs, and we need to use the Android hardware abstraction layers. So once again, sensor FW uses libhybris backends to use the bionic libraries that are provided by OEMs. Example of apps include this Compass app that has been developed by someone from the community. It's just a few lines of code. It's a nice showcase of the capabilities of Qtquick. Using the QML declarative capabilities, you can bind the rotation angle of an image to the actual angle between your watch and the north. And with just a few lines of code, you get a Compass app running. Another example of app is this one right here. The quality is pretty bad, but the idea was to develop a red square that moves through the screen depending on the position of your arm. So you can imagine doing all kinds of games on your smartwatch with this. Or someone was talking about, during the keynote, someone was talking about fall detection for elderly, and this is something you could easily implement with those things. Another example of stack that is specifically needed on this kind of embedded device is the haptic feedback. So you often want your watch to vibrate on a specific event. For example, when you get a notification, when a timer is elapsed, or when an alarm clock is triggered. So once again, same problem, we provide high-level APIs. Qt provides us Qt feedback so that QML developers can easily trigger the call to vibration. Qt feedback itself doesn't do anything. It would like to use the FF-minus backend, which is the standard way of handling vibration on a device. But we have vendor kernels, we don't have FF-minus drivers, so we need to use the Android hardware abstraction layers and to libhybris. And one very last example of the same issues, because it can be very amusing to use, the audio stack. High-level APIs provided by Qt, named Qt Multimedia, communicates with the daemon that most of you already know. PulseAudio probably runs on your desktop Linux, this system. And PulseAudio itself loads several modules, and among those modules, you can find a libhybris backend. This libhybris app backend tries to bind things between the Android stack and the PulseAudio stack, and you get microphone capabilities. So most of the smartwatches don't have speakers, of course some have, but you can use the microphone. And something I have in mind since the beginning of the project is to develop a personal assistant, and it has been brought to my attention that there are great open source personal assistants existing today, such as this one named Lucida, which is developed by university in the USA. And I would love to see Lucida being integrated into AsteroidOS eventually. So once again, if you want to contribute, this can be a funny task to work on. And that's pretty much it for the different stacks I wanted to talk about. So as you can see, there are plenty of components involved in AsteroidOS. Most of them have hardware-specific problematics. And what this means is that handling this complexity is in itself a large task. So what we typically do in embedded systems is that we use a build system. Well-known build systems include Bilboot, which is great for small firmwares, and also OpenEmbedded. So in AsteroidOS, I decided to use OpenEmbedded. It is often known as Yocto, but technically speaking, those are two different things. The Yocto project is something from the Linux Foundation that helps documenting and developing the OpenEmbedded build system. It's a good thing that it exists, because before Yocto, the OpenEmbedded documentation was a nightmare. Actually, there was no documentation, so it wasn't even a nightmare, it just didn't exist. And OpenEmbedded is the build system itself. So I won't try to explain you the... I don't have the pretension of making you understand the full capabilities of OpenEmbedded in the 10 minutes that I have left. But I will try to give you a very general idea of what it does and how. So what we want from this build system is to generate an image that can be flashed on our devices. So smartwatches typically have an unlockable bootloader that can flash partitions under a specific format. So we need to specify to OpenEmbedded the way images such as the rootfs and the kernel and init RAM disk are packaged and generated. So this is the image target. In AsteroidOS, the image is named Asteroid image. So this image is generated from packages, and packages is what you are used to from your Linux desktop system. OpenEmbedded handles Debian packages, RPM packages, and also OPKG packages. In AsteroidOS, I chose to use OPKG since it's slightly more lightweight, but it's really easy to change if you want to use Debian packages. Those packages are actually generated from source, and they are cross-compiled by a tool named Bitbake. And Bitbake knows how to generate those packages thanks to recipes. Recipes are kind of scripts describing how to fetch, patch, configure, compile, install, package, do quality assurance, etc. From a source tree. And usually those recipes are gathered into layers that provide related components. So for example, if I take this stack from the bottom up, I take the example of the meta asteroid layer. This is just an example. It provides a recipe for asteroid launcher, which is named asteroid_launcher_git.bb, which compiles asteroid launcher from the latest Git revision. This recipe generate several packages. Among those packages, for example, there is the Asteroid Launcher, which includes the binary itself, but also Asteroid Launcher DBG, which is helpful to install when you want to debug your smartwatch. And Asteroid Launcher depends on another package named Lipstick, which is also compiled from a different recipe. So Bitbake knows those dependencies. There are build dependencies and also runtime dependencies, and it will install everything that is needed in your actual image in the end. So describing the process of compiling every component in AsteroidOS was a lot of work, and there are a couple of layers that are used in AsteroidOS. The most important one by far is Meta Asteroid. It includes almost 100 different recipes for all kinds of apps, daemons, libraries, and everything. But there are also other layers providing different components. For example, there is a Meta Qt5 layer explaining how to build Qt base, Qt feedback, Qt multimedia, Qt wayland, etc. meta smartphone layer that provides the recipe for libhybris. And then the standard meta OpenEmbedded and OE core layers that explain how to build the basic Linux components such as systemd, udev, blue-zinc, Kernel, etc. Those were layers that I named apps layers, but there is also a different kind of layers, which is named BSP layers. BSP stands for Board Support Package, which means that this layer is supposed to handle the hardware compatibility of your generated OpenEmbedded system for a specific device. And we have one different layer for every supported smartwatch. So there are photos of, I think all of these supported smartwatches are here. Maybe I missed one of them. But we have a layer for every one of them. And this layer is in charge of providing the vendor kernel, compiling it from source, and also providing the Android hardware abstraction layers, which are usually, unfortunately, available in pre-built binary form. So if you want to get involved in the project in a task named porting AsteroidOS, you can write your own BSP layer. You provide the kernel, a couple of patches are needed to the kernel, and you provide the Android blobs that you can grab from your Android installation. And you generate a build from OpenEmbedded, you flash it to your watch, and usually it kind of works, and then then it becomes like that. So if you are interested in the project, please join the Asteroid IRC channel on Freenode. You can also visit the AsteroidOS.org website to learn more about the project. There is a lot of documentation in here. And you can also follow the development on the AsteroidOS Twitter account. Thanks a lot for your attention, and do you have questions?
So a quick question: is there some kind of smartwatch that you would recommend if people want to try this out, and what kind of hardware should we buy? Thanks.
Okay. So as you noticed, most of the hardware compatibility is based on Android, and you need the vendor kernel. So actually, only Androidware smartwatches provide you the vendor kernel source tree. So I would recommend you to get an Androidware smartwatch and avoid the very cheap other Android smartwatches. I have written a porting status page that details the hardware compatibility of the different smartwatches. And currently the most supported one, because this is the one I started, because this is the one with which I started working on AsteroidOS, is this one, the LG G-Watch. This is also the cheapest. I chose this one so that contributors can enter the project with without a high budget, and in France you can buy it for $30 on second hand, 40 euros, sorry. And on my wrist I have the LG Watch Urban, which is slightly more expensive but also more beautiful. Those are the two most well supported smartwatches.
And they usually don't lock down the bootloader on those?
Yeah, all the Androidware smartwatches have an unlockable bootloader, but and there is a but. All of the smartwatches that are here have pinouts. So if I remove my watch, behind the watch you get a couple of pins that are actually USB port. So you get a dock with which you can connect your watch to your computer. But recently Google has started pushing smartwatches on the market that are loaded, that are charged with induction, so you don't have those pinouts, and you don't have access to the bootloader, which means you have no easy way to flash AsteroidOS, no easy way to debug it while working on the porting process. So it may become harder and harder to port AsteroidOS, but those smartwatches have pins and an unlockable bootloader, which is great.
What is the maturity status of the project? Do you see any commercial products coming out to using this operating system?
Okay, so I haven't released the stable release yet of AsteroidOS. It's still in the it is still tagged alpha, but some users are already using it on a daily basis. I try to work with companies for example, for porting or demonstration. And for example, I worked with Yola on the Sailfish Watch demonstration. So you may have heard about the Sailfish Watch, and this is a common effort. There is a Yola employee here that can confirm this.
Yes, that's what happened, but it's not, I mean, the operating system is not complete in any way, so...
Yeah, sure.
So the operating system is not complete in any way, even when it's ported to the with the Sailfish OS UI on it. But it's, I think it's getting there. Good job so far.
So I expect I'm really bad with roadmaps and deadlines, but I expect a stable release for the summer of 2017. So hopefully we will get there.
Are there plans for an app store or a Wi-Fi support? Two questions.
Okay. So I would want to have Wi-Fi for the app store because sending apps through Bluetooth Low Energy can be done, but it's not. You don't have a very high bitrate, so it's not very interesting. And Wi-Fi capabilities is not my priority for the 1.0 stable release, but that will be my priority for the second release. So my plan for starting from today to the stable release is to fix bugs. Feature-wise, this is mostly complete, and I don't want to touch the features in the coming months. So I don't plan to work on Wi-Fi UI integration during the next few months, but you can already use the Wi-Fi capabilities from the terminal, and some users have already used, for example, MQTT over Wi-Fi on their smartwatch, but this is not well integrated to the UI. You need to hack things around. But that's part of the beauty of the project, you can change things and have fun.
What kind of other profiles are you working on? You had the what was it, notifications and
okay. So the list was here. So we have the notification profiles. When you get a notification or when you remove it, when you remove it from the phone, it disappears from the watch and vice versa. The media profile, you control your app, your phone's music player from your watch. Battery profile, you get the battery status of your watch from your phone. Screenshot profile, you can take screenshots of your smartwatch from your phone. Time synchronization, so that you get the time of your phone on your watch. And also the weather profile, that so there is a task on your phone that regularly gets information from Open Weather Map, and that saves those data in the deconf cache of your watch and shows them in the Asteroid Weather app.
And how many developers are working on this?
So I've mostly
on
been
the whole project.
On the whole project, yeah. I've mostly been working alone for 2 years now on my free time. And I get some contributions, for example, for hardware porting. Those are the watches I have ported myself, so this is my arm. And the other ones are from other persons. Actually, I have not done this port here. So I did those three ports. And the other are from contributors. Other example of contributions include the AsteroidOS Linux client from a community member, and then a couple of bug fixes and pull requests that I get from time to time. So I would not say I am fully alone, but everything I presented here comes from me. And thankfully, there are some components that have been developed, for example, by Qt or Yola, and that I will use in AsteroidOS. So it's a lot of work, but it's possible thanks to the efforts of other open source projects.
Is there a smartwatch without the Broadcom Bluetooth?
With all the smartwatches that I have worked with, there was the Broadcom chip. And I assume that Google provides some reference devices to the watch manufacturer. So actually, most of them are using the same system on chip. With the same system on chip and a different form factor, you can pay twice the price just because it is marketed better. So most of the hardware is actually pretty much the same between these smartwatches. And I have never met a smartwatch without this crappy firmware, which is really badly written. There is a tool to start this firmware, and it has hard-coded hexadecimal values, which caused all kind of battery life issues and a lot of fun with those things.
So when will you fix the Apple Watch?
when I will have more time. Any more questions?
You said something about very good battery life. Is it better than the regular Android?
It's actually on the regular Android Wear device operating system. You can choose to have an always-on display. So basically, the screens get very low brightness, and it only shows the time in white, and the rest of the screen is black. With AMOLED technologies, you get very low consumption. And this thing is not supported in AsteroidOS, so it's hard to compare a watch with Android Wear that has an always-on display with a watch with AsteroidOS that doesn't, that just turns off the display like this. But I would say that with the same, by disabling the always-on capability of Android Wear, you get pretty much the same battery life between AsteroidOS and Android Wear.
What plans do you have for future versions of AsteroidOS? Do you have any exciting visions?
So of course there is the App Store I want to work on, but before developing the App Store I wanted to have developers. That's the reason why my main goal was to release the first version that is stable and provides a basis, and then think about developers and the App Store. And the second thing I would love to have is the personal assistant I talked about. And it's not as hard as it seems to be, since there are already great open source projects working on it. And I think it's important. It's a nice usage of smartwatches, and most of the personal assistants today are centralized services running in American servers that you don't have access to. And even if you have an open source system on your watch, if you send all your data to a server somewhere else, you don't really have an open experience. So that will be my focus for the next, for the Aster 2.0. But we are not at this 1.0 yet, so let's not get too excited right away. Other questions?